For the introduction, I'll quickly introduce my company first. We are a research and advisory firm, and we also produce events. So the easiest way to introduce is you all have heard of publications like CIO, PC World. Those are published by our parent company called IDG. And we are the research wing of IDG, and we do research across different technology areas and provide advisory services primarily to technology industry. I know the group here knows about ARVR a lot, so I would not get into the definition of what is the difference between ARVR, but our view is that it is kind of converging in probably near to medium term. To long term, it is kind of going to converge somewhere. And the reason we say that is because if you see a lot of standalone devices have come up with inside-out tracking, and in fact, a lot of it is getting embedded into even smartphones. We are seeing a lot of depth perception capabilities being embedded into such smartphones as well. So which means AR/VR is going to converge in medium to long term, where it wouldn't be like that AR is only bringing digital objects into physical world and VR is completely concealed where you don't have any understanding of your environment. Coming to what really is going on in terms of funding. There's a good joke in Silicon Valley now that if even if you speak or pass a joke about AR/VR, you can probably land up with funding. It's more difficult than that. We all know that. It's just a joke, but certainly there is a lot of funding that is being driven into AR/VR. In fact, very recently, there's a company called Improbable which raised about $500 million from SoftBank. It's a UK-based firm. They are about 6 years old, very small, but raised $500 million. And they actually develop what you can call as a virtualization software. Most of the gaming engines run on one server kind of architecture, so they are actually splitting that workloads of games into different servers. So you can think of them as a Citrix or a VMware from the technology industry, and they have done it for the gaming industry. And so if you're doing something different, there is of course money there. HTC is committed there. Facebook closed its own content studios, which may be good news for some of us here. And they are going for a funding model there, so they have committed to $50 million for there. So certainly there is a lot of money, but of course one need to differentiate there in terms of in terms of technology, or of course if there is great content which is being built. Pokemon Go actually earned $1 billion. They reached $1 billion revenues, and this is the fastest ever that any game had reached. And we know there was a big craze around it, so certainly that proves the potential, that there is a lot of potential in AR/VR, which Pokemon Go proves. And certainly Pokemon Go has a very interesting business model as well, that besides gaming, they also provide these gyms that we are all aware of. So they partnered with McDonald's. They started in Japan, and then they went ahead with a number of similar partnerships, which is again a business model where they are not just making revenues, it's a freemium model where, right, they are giving games for free, but they are making money in other ways. To next, in terms of now, a lot of enterprise software vendors, large vendors, are actually getting interested. So Adobe has actually just about a few weeks back acquired a company called SkyTool, which many of you would be aware of. They are are basically a VR, toolkit, which actually helps you create. So they are integrating it with their even Creative Cloud, which means a lot of marketing will have, where Adobe is a preferred platform, will have AR/VR capabilities. Similarly, Oracle is doing that. We know Windows 10 is talking big about, 3D. So it is natively going to come to a lot of offices which are running on the Windows platform. So certainly it is going to, kind of reaching towards mainstream. We already know that Apple has launched ARKit, which is good news, they have been shying away from it for a long time, but kind of agreed that yes, they would launch ARKit, which will spur a lot of development into their existing infrastructure, which is smartphones and tablets. So that is one area certainly that a lot of people are looking at, and of course in China, Baidu has launched a similar platform. There's a similar platform. Google Lens is coming to a number of devices, and Google has launched Tango. So certainly it is kind of going democratic in terms of a number of devices that are available out there. Now coming to the important question, so how big is the market? And we predict, and this is based on our annual prediction. It actually is semi-annual, so we do it twice a year. This was based on February data. We look at various sectors, and it's a bottom-up model. So we looked at use cases, we look at industries, and there are about 26 use cases as of now. But there are others which are, you know, use cases that we have looked at, and we look at the number of data that we have, you know. So it includes hardware, software, and services. It is going to actually grow from, you know, almost kind of double from 2016 in 2017 to about $13 billion. That includes, you know, all of hardware spent as well, and we are not counting any cardboards there. So it is going to be, you know, the growth is kind of going to be, you know, exponential, as you can see. Which are the sectors which are actually adopting it faster than others, you know, from an enterprise perspective? Certainly personal and consumer services is one of the drivers. But retail is kind of, you know, one of the areas which is, which will drive highest spending. We already see a lot of retail stores which are including virtual mirrors, or, you know, even a lot of e-commerce websites which are including avatars, or how you can actually try a cloth or spectacles. Those kind of services are already getting embedded into existing platforms. And we will see some of the examples on the next slide. But Asia Pacific is going to be one of the largest regions as well on a geographic basis. In fact, it will grow much faster than a lot of other regions because of the existing infrastructure that is available in this space. Moving on, so what are, you know, what will be the spending? You know, what are organizations or people achieving out of this? So there are certainly a lot of, you know, areas where AR/VR is being applied, and, you know, these are actually the drivers for AR/VR. These are new products and services which are being developed. Korea has a cafe called VR Plus. They don't charge for VR experiences; they charge for coffee, and, you know, that's their business model. So, but it's called a VR cafe, so certainly their business is, you know, VR. Similarly, Lotte in South Korea again is a retail store where they're using a lot of AR/VR solutions in store. Interactive solutions, certainly, in terms of, if you look at, you know, workstations, and we know, you know, in Singapore there are a lot of traders. So a trader would generally have like 5-6 screens, and, you know, he's trying to toggle between these screens to put orders. So GMO Click in Japan has created basically a VR application where you can do all the trading in basically a VR headset. So that's the kind of imagination that is going on, and it's not just happening in Japan. Citibank is kind of working on it. There is another Swiss bank called Swissquote which has already launched this service. And these are commercially available services. So you have a VR headset, so you are actually virtualizing the entire desktop environment. And you are putting all those 6-5 screens, whatever you have, in one you know, screen, which is a VR headset. And this is, again, as I said, you know, commercially available as of you know, today. You can go to their website and, you know, actually download their application. Of course, in terms of training and collaboration, that's another big area. A lot of enterprises are looking at training and collaboration, and that is certainly one area where a lot of opportunity for developers is, for content creators is, because even enterprises will look for a lot of you know, training content. So gaming is certainly one. You know, there is also gamification, which is important in enterprises, where they are looking at how they can actually gamify and actually look at you know, a lot of training content to be interactive. And these are actually, you know, enterprises, for example, from financial services, from oil and gas, and a number of other sectors, which are looking at this. So that's another big opportunity area in terms of training and collaboration. So Microsoft, for instance, has partnered with Pearson, which is a large, you know, content provider, learning and content provider. But there is certainly, you know, content is something, you know, especially from a training perspective, which is very localized. So every country has different nuances in terms of language, in terms of mannerisms. So certainly there is a huge opportunity in terms of training and collaboration as well from a training perspective. And this is kind of the ecosystem if you look at, you know, very quickly. Certainly we know on the lowest level there are headsets. That is also, you know, it's not just headsets, but a lot of haptics and other devices, simulators. Actually unidimensional or any or, you know, actually treadmills where you can actually walk anywhere. So those kind of treadmills are coming up, as well as sensors. But what is also interesting is there are a lot of sector applications on top, you can see, which is towards healthcare, retail, there are a number of other, you know, sector-specific applications, even in industrial sectors, that are coming up. In fact, there's a company called GHD in Australia. It's an industrial consultancy. It actually acquired a VR content firm so that they can offer basically VR-based industrial consultancy services. Deloitte in Australia also acquired a VR company called Kidneon so that they can offer it to their customers. So what are the challenges? I think, you know, most of us know what the challenges are, but what we hear from a lot of enterprises and customers that I meet is around, of course, content. It's kind of a challenge that has been spoken about a lot of times. I will not focus more on that. But, you know, imperfect experience is another one that, you know, has been talked about. There are issues around weight, dizziness, et cetera, et cetera. But there are a lot of opportunities if you see on the right-hand side, because this is kind of, you know, a lot of these are related. As technology kind of advances, a lot of these will get solved. Certainly, there will be more momentum in terms of skill development and growth that we see. And, of course, these kind of meetups help there get more people interested in it. There will be a lot of disintermediation, as we have seen in the case of internet era, where internet emerged as a platform and a lot of businesses emerged out of it. So we are seeing that's kind of a natural progression where AR VR is moving towards, it is emerging as a platform. Alibaba launched a store; it was a VR store, and it was kind of very popular during the Singles Day sale last year, and in fact the sales were highest ever. So. You could actually, what they launched was that they brought a number of stores from which are very popular, like Macy's in the US, into this virtual reality platform. So you can actually walk into this store in Macy's, New York, and you can select bags or whatever you want, you know, goodies there. Entertainment and out-of-door VR is certainly, again, gaining traction. We see a lot of companies that are in warehouse and, you know, other out-of-gaming that are really successful. But, you know, I think the biggest impact will be mobile-based ARVR, because there's a huge infrastructure that is already available. It's easy to actually consume. And a lot of, you know, if you see examples like Google Tango, where it is being embedded, a lot of technologies like depth perception is being embedded, will actually improve, the experiences on even smartphones, smartphone-based ARVR. So in the near term, that will certainly be a big driver. All right, certainly there are a lot of opportunities, so what are some of the risks? And this is not to scare anyone, but just to kind of give some example in terms of what really should be one careful of when you're building content. I would not talk about health and safety, because we all know people have done crazy things for Pokemon Go, so that's kind of well understood. In fact, there were two brothers who in US actually crossed over to the Canada while playing the game without realizing. So, and all sorts of crazy stuff. But, you know, ethics and privacy is one area where, you know, one need to be very sure of in terms of what they are building. A lot of, kind of lawsuits might emerge there. Similarly, financial compliance, a lot of games utilize coins or virtual currency. So that is one area where one should look at in terms of, because for example in Japan, the financial services authority there actually is trying to regulate the games, or even the, for example, poker coins, right? So virtual currency there will be regulated, and one has to actually report and put it into bank accounts. So that is going to take place there. And of course, intellectual property and religious beliefs. So there were lawsuits against Pokemon Go in certain countries, because they had put these gyms, or basically where you could go, were also in areas like crematorium and memorials, and there were actual lawsuits. So sometimes even religious places of worship, and somebody got offended. So anyway, but there were actually lawsuits that were that were filed against Pokemon Go. And here are some examples. The first one I already mentioned, Japan is going to regulate virtual currency that is being used, and a lot of games have some sort of virtual currency. There are child protection laws which actually apply there, because a person, an underage person, may be very keen to buy a lot of this, and we have seen that happening in case of, for example, even areas like Amazon, where kids have ordered, you know, for example, toys or other things from Alexa, and those kind of issues have emerged. Similarly, a very good example is for Electronic Arts, where they utilize the football, you know, this is for college football. The characters in the game, it very popular football series from Electronic Arts, and they actually paid $40 million to settle the lawsuit because the athletes were lookalikes of the actual players, but you know, they were wearing the same jerseys, but they were not paid royalties and they were not using the same names. So finally they settled the lawsuit. So that's, you know, one area. And of course, you know, this is, I think the third one is more from an enterprise perspective, but there would be a lot more, you know, that's from a health and safety perspective, where enterprises see that there could be a lot of insurance and other kind of risks that will emerge. Also, there are talks about, you know, psychological risks and others, but I think, you know, it's still early days in terms of, you know, determining are there real risks, because even in healthcare, VR is actually helping solve a lot of medical problems. It's being used in therapy today. You know, it is also helping solve a lot of psychological problems. So I think that is kind of, you know, overstated. But certainly, you know, health and safety risks is something that is more for enterprises to look at. If people are, you know, using these tools, they are not getting hurt, not really for developers. And finally, I think, you know, to summarize, I think it's not just about creativity. I think, you know, a lot of enterprises and, you know, business leaders that I meet, even in marketing, they talk about that one could be very good, you know, creatively, but it's, if there is no story, there is no soul in it, and there isn't, you know, something that we can take to customers, even from a marketing perspective. So certainly it is more important in gaming and, you know, other forms. And everything as a service, so it is good to productize a lot of, you know, solutions that you have, because there's a lot of euphoria now. Some of the startups that I have met are saying that we have more demand than we can meet, but that is not going to last. So if you are creating a solution, a platform that is going to help you, because you know that will be recurring revenues for you, because everything is available, you know, as a service. So, you know, probably best way is to productize and offer it as a service over a long period of time, where you go for a pay-as-you-go model. And finally, you know, technology is changing very rapidly, so certainly keep your options open. Without over-investing, you know, in the near term over, you know, or signing up for just one technology area or developing something, you know, grounds up for one technology area. And certainly keeping that open mind in terms of what is coming up will also help, you know, embrace new technologies, not just, you know, being locked down, but certainly embrace even new technologies. With that, I will end. And if there are any questions. Happy to take any questions, if there are any. All right, thank you.
Maybe questions. okay. No questions.
Are going to converge at some point of time.
Yeah.
I didn't really get like how is like what do you mean by that statement?
Yeah. So if you see today, the way AR is defined is. You know, we defined it as, okay, you're bringing digital objects to your physical environment, right? That's about how you define what is augmented reality. You are bringing digital objects to your physical environment. And virtual reality, in its simplest sense, it was when you are completely concealed. You know, you don't have understanding of your physical surroundings. That's, you know, you bring a completely virtual environment around you. But if you see a lot of devices now that are coming up, or you know, if you look at even from a roadmap perspective, they're talking about inside-out tracking, which means you have, you know, understanding of the physical environment. And that is also kind of desired. A lot of, you know, so one of the challenges there is that, okay, when you are cut out from the physical environment, you are actually exposed to a lot of physical hazards or, you know, safety hazards out there, right? So the point is that, you know, it would not be AR or VR, it will be kind of mixed reality, like say what Microsoft calls it, or you know, merged reality, what Qualcomm calls it, or you know, hybrid reality, or any other form of reality, but it will not necessarily be just, you know, like the Chinese walls of, okay, AR is bringing physical, you know, digital to physical, and you know, virtual, VR is completely virtual. Exactly, they would not be, you know, completely pure VR, and that's also kind of desired if you see, you know, in a lot of inside-out tracking devices, they come with front-facing cameras, they come with, you know, more sensors are getting embedded there.
Okay, any more questions? Okay, I have one question. I mean, many of our members here are actually working on getting a lot of feedback. Yeah, I mean, many of the members here do work on VR applications on different verticals and industries applications. So, and you did share some of the challenges on the adoption side, but what do you think are the biggest challenges for industry adoption of virtual reality technology?
So from an enterprise perspective, I think, you know, people are understanding the value in terms of, you know, for marketing and advertisements, for instance. So there, people have understood that, okay, there is a business case here, we need to do this, right? But if you look at, you know, other areas, there are not even solutions out there. In fact, a lot of, you know, CIOs are even wary of, for example, as I said, you know, investing, because they know if I'm going to invest in this technology today, tomorrow that technology, you know, can be, you know, something better is coming. So there is kind of one reluctance there in terms of investing, because if you see from a, you know, enterprise technology perspective, they invest, you know, in a 3-year kind of time frame. You know, even for devices, minimum of 3-year kind of time frame. But if you see that, you know, it's something better is going to come next fall or in the next 3 months, so there's some form of reluctance. The second most, you know, of important factor there is that if you look at a lot of enterprise software vendors, you know, they have only begun to now look at it seriously. As I said, you know, Adobe added in October last year tools for marketing, while I'm sure a lot of people, you know, even in the audience here would have been developing marketing videos for like, you know, 2-3 years at least for VR, right? But Adobe did not do it, you know, until now, because they were kind of, you know, wait and watch kind of I think it's a tendency that, you know, a lot of enterprise vendors have, because they make huge investments then and they go after it. So that is the second one, where there are not a lot of solutions which are available for enterprises. And they know that, you know, there are mixed signals that are coming up. Okay, it is successful, it is not successful. So, you know, that is kind of, you know, what is playing out in the mind, right?
Great.
So during my work, I actually stumbled upon a lot of CIO of the enterprise world. So because for me, I focus on enterprise VR. So by talking to them, they always ask the question. Actually, most of them ask this question, like, how long will you think this hardware will last me for? Is it 5 years? Is it 3 years? So my, I always counter it by saying that, you know, for HTC Vive, it's actually pretty good because it's, you can add on like lenses, they got the auto stripe, you can just add on it. So actually, if they most likely wouldn't be updating the newer version of HTC Vive that soon, that means they need to replace it. So mostly it's just add on. So this is just one way for me to counter that. Do you have any suggestion on that? Because that will make it easier for people that is working on enterprise VR to get the CIO on board so that they can start to use our software.
Sure, I think that's a, you know, a very good point. But if you see, you know, when I talk from an enterprise perspective, it is, you know, large enterprises have other, you know, issues, right? So for example, they have to write down, you know, every piece of hardware that they buy for 5 years. So that is not something that, you know, or actually 3 years based on regulations in each country that they operate in, that they will have to write it down. But I think, you know, whenever the question is around hardware, unless you are, you know, kind of selling and bundling hardware, the conversation should be kind of away from it. You should draw the conversation away from hardware to what your platform can do, and you have to, you know, build that confidence that you are looking at what is happening on the hardware ecosystem. Your platform is kind of hardware agnostic, because, you know, if you are offering it as a platform, you really don't want, you know, to get into that conversation to guide that which is the best hardware. And, you know, if you stay away from that discussion, you can give, you know, like suggestion of these three are the best, or, you know, that would work on our platform, but you can always say that we are looking at hardware. So whichever hardware you buy tomorrow, I'm telling you that my platform will work on, you know, because my platform is hardware agnostic. My solution is hardware agnostic. Easier said than done, but yeah, I think, you know, that's what you should, you know, go after.
Okay, so I think we'll move on to the, if you have more questions after the talk, we still have some time, you can actually grab hold of Avinash. So, okay, we'll thank Avinash for the great talk.